definitely it.
It's what it should have been and what it is.
Yeah, it's great.
Looks great.
Really good.
Well, this is good. There's going to be a show in Soho worth seeing this for.
So you do like it.
Surprised that he wanted to open with my work, because there are other artists who could have opened the gallery and who are quite well known also. So it's a unique opportunity for me in terms of re-entering the New York gallery scene.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Well, Lorna Simpson is one of the foremost practitioners of what I would describe as post-conceptual art. She's not confined to a single medium. It's a very rare thing that you find that kind of intellectual inquiry and that kind of consistency and qualitative thinking presented in a single package alongside work which is both intriguing and dare one say also, I think, very beautiful in many respects. She is an African-American woman. There are all sorts of expectations and how you deal with those. Lorna's incredibly stylish about the way in which she deals with all of those issues, takes all of those issues and steers it back towards, no, it's not about me, it's not about this issue, it's not about what my ethnic background is, it's about the work. If she wasn't a great artist, it wouldn't matter what those other issues were.
What's on the other side, Lorna? Was that the mistake?
Bad print?
Oh, no, I'm just asking.
$32 a pop.
Mm-hmm.
For material.
I know the felt. I know.
So when did these images start?
Thelma Golden is a curator at the Whitney Museum of American Art. She's somebody who has a relatively unique ability to persuade almost anybody that they should engage themselves in looking at work that is very often very difficult for them to deal with.
I mean, since the pieces have to do with sex or public sex and private acts in public spaces, I'm thinking of different environments that are cues.
And did the texts that go with these sort of refer specifically?
Yeah, so yeah, the text, and it refers to the site. So this one, I mean, there's text about a sociologist who studies the activities of men in public bathrooms and kind of his role or kind of how he goes about his study.
The park, and in the fact that it's an aerial view of a park at night, kind of has a two-sided thing. It's about watching what goes on in the park, as well as how the trees and the bushes act as cover and shelter and creates these kind of secluded areas. That's the way that either it entices or positions the viewer.
And the text that goes with it is though there were small narratives, kind of not so much describing acts themselves, but describing individuals and rendezvous. This is photography voyeurism about watching people who have sex in public. I mean, so there's many different layers in the way that the text kind of approaches the imagery and the act itself. It's not so much about describing it, but then how does one meet or select a particular space, and how do you get around the space or that environment and around the fact that it is public.
And here we have a very strong body of work where the figure is wholly absent, where the context is constructed by the text, and yet there is that real sense of presence. There's that real sense that the body is imminent, or the body has been there or will be there.
In an office building with light, which is nice to have at 2 o'clock, since it's about two people meeting after work, mm-hmm. and thinking of and choosing a place within the building. Mm-hmm. So it's kind of about time and architecture and
wow.
What space is available. Mm-hmm. Of about this rendezvous where they feel that there's some safety or area that they can have an intimate act, and kind of the text then goes back and forth about figuring out that space architecturally vis-a-vis the hours of the day in terms of the volume of people that go through there and what time would be convenient to meet.
It's almost like you're eavesdropping on something, and that refers back to the voice in the text in the way that you're almost hearing something you're not meant to hear. You're finding something you weren't quite supposed to find.
Is really about descriptions. So it's kind of encoding a different description on what you would take as just a beautiful cityscape or a beautiful landscape and inscribing something else on it. I mean, it's been kind of complicated in process, mm-hmm. but I mean, once you have it up on the wall and it's done, it looks very simple mm-hmm. and kind of minimal. Which is what I like, but I certainly wish it were a minimal place to get to
right.
in terms of process.
If you pick the right artists and you give them a modicum of security and confidence, and I'm not talking about financial, I'm talking about emotional and psychological, then you create a context for those artists to grow. It's really about being confident in their work. And I think that somebody like Lorna is a very good example. She is famous at this point. She has had that kind of initial attention.
In working with a dealer, it's not just about making money, which everyone loves and enjoys, but it's also about thinking about the work in terms of a career and thinking about planning things in terms of the work, in terms of opportunities to make new works and to really practice as an artist.
We're very much a part of the process, every stage of that process. It's never an issue of, you know, the truck rolls up and the art comes off the truck. That is not the way we work. We work over a long period of time and try and contribute to the creative process of the artist.
But you do need, it's like all four corners, because as you can see,
yeah.
No, he has a lot of confidence in me as an artist in terms of that he's secure enough to go with that. So I have my fingers crossed it all goes well.